did not have one. One minute before. Right?
We always come.
It was
the
time for the triple record for
a post. All right.
1 minute before.
All right. So, looking at your calculus survival guide. This is going to come with you every day next week. And then you are, I know with certainty, you are going to take this with you to college. I have no doubt. All the alum always do. This is organized in ways that none of your other things are going to get organized. So you are going to have the very first thing is your table of contents. Now, I asked you guys to bring in 20 dividers. Apparently, you only really needed 17. But I don't think you can go to Office Depot and buy 17. Okay? Section 1, you should have a little tab numbered Section 1. And behind Section 1 is going to be Unit 1, Limits and Continuity. You have a packet titled Unit 1, Limits and Continuity. Please put it there. And then it's obvious after that. Section 2 is Unit 2, Section 3 is Unit 3, and so on all the way down. Section 9 is the Calculus BC Survival Guide. You don't know any of the content that's in there yet, and it's okay. But I will tell you, I really need to see the dividers because we're going to be flipping back and forth all the time, and you want to know, like, section 5. I don't want you to be like, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Number it. Okay? So take a couple minutes, get it built. We'll talk about section 10. Lewis. Yes, please. Make it quick. How did the unit test go?
It went well.
For the most part, went well?
For the most part.
I was really excited. Lots and lots of you all earned a perfect score on the multiple choice part of the quiz, which I'm going to pass back right now. And free response went generally really well, so high scores. Steven, here you go. Ilay, here you go. Giselle. Okay, Lewis. Carmen. Andrew. Myra. Palamon, I gave you yours yesterday. Alright, we could maybe take one or two more minutes to build the survival guide, and then you're actually going to do a scavenger hunt using the survival guide. Hopefully the folks at East End and North Central and Southeast have already gotten all the materials from their group of calculus teachers. Okay. Other things you need to know about. Section 10 is the index. We're going to loop back around and talk about the index in a little bit. I will tell you the index was a 5-hour labor of love to put the index together so that you can find things quickly. I even endured part of the movie White Chicks. I thought, oh, I'll watch this for a little bit. And then I lost my mind. I'm like, I can't do this anymore. Section 11 is where you're going to put handouts that are titled Special Topics. You're about to get one. This is not going to be in the unit packet. Section 12 is where all your graded work is going to go. Section 13, there's a goal setting document, but you don't actually have that right now. Section 14, practice test. Section 15, you should have a handout that says TI-inspired calculator instructions. This is not something that I created, it's something that I found, but it goes like step by step through lots of different things. Section 16, there's a parent function survival guide, so it has all your friendly little graphs. And section 17 is a pre-calculus summary of all the things that you learned last year. All right, any questions about the survival guide? Palamon is in your... Oh, I get to take yours back. Ooh. seriously, I have spent too much time working on this to give it to you without a binder and divider. Good news though, you can still do all the work. Alright, so let's talk about what the next couple days are going to look like. Today, there is no new stuff. This is like we're pausing from all the ABBC action. It's going to be a review, specifically a review of every theorem that we've come across that has a name. Examples include
IVC.
Fundamental Theorem of Calculus, the Intermediate Value Theorem of Calculus.
The squeeze theorem.
I should have put the squeeze theorem. I didn't think about the squeeze theorem. The mean value theorem. The second fundamental theorem of calculus, all the things, all those named theorems show up on a pretty regular basis, so we're going to spend today reviewing and working on some problems with that. Monday, we're going to do a review of physics, all the particle motion. Tuesday, in class, you are going to take a multiple choice portion of the benchmark exam. The AP exam in May has four parts. The first part is multiple choice, calculator, inactive. You have to do 30 questions in 60 minutes. No lie, 30 questions, 60 minutes. You have to move wicked fast. Very likely you won't finish that section on time. No one ever does. Steven, I know that that's a personal challenge for you. I have never seen one of my students finish the multiple choice, calculator, inactive and be like, hey, now what do I do with the time I have left? You won't. After that, there is section two, which is more multiple choice, calculator active. 15 questions, 45 minutes. You will finish that early. You will finish that one early, most likely. And then you're gonna be like, hey, can I go back to section one? No. We then take a short break. Section three is two free response questions, calculator active, two questions, 30 minutes. Section four is four free response questions, 60 minutes. By that point, by the end of section four, actually for some of you it'll be somewhere at the beginning of section four, the will to live will have left your body. And still you will write, and still you will work. You're not gonna write me a note that says, sorry, Mr. DeRozier, I've just stopped now. You have to keep going, Lewis.
Did you do that one time?
Not quite that, but it was close. So Tuesday, so today we're reviewing new stuff. Monday we're going to review new stuff. Tuesday is the multiple choice test. Wednesday I'll give you guys some feedback in class. Wednesday we take the test after school here in this room, starting as close to 1:15 as we can. Yes, I will have some snacks available for you. David, you don't need to bring in the kolaches. I will take care of you all, I promise. You'll be done by 4 o'clock. I promise. Any questions about next week? Thanks, Paloma. And then Thursday and Friday, we're going to go back to Calculus BC. We're going to learn new things. We're going to work with vectors, parametric equations, polar curves, all the things. Lewis, it's going to be okay. All right, so everybody go to the index. This is section 10. Section 10. All right, so that we all know how to use section 10 appropriately. I know because I built the calculus survival guide pretty much where all the things are. That's not your reality. If I said, hey, where's the mean value theorem? I need you to know where in your calculus survival guide you're going to go to. So find the mean value theorem. Where is this in your survival guide? Index, mean value theorem. Mean value theorem. There's the process for the mean value theorem. That's unit 4, page 4. And then there's the statement of the mean value theorem, unit 4, page 4. So at that point, you'd say, oh, unit 4. Let me go back to section 4. Let me flip over to page 4. Here's everything on the mean value theorem. The first 2 years we did the survival guide, I didn't do an index, and the survival guide wasn't nearly as useful for folks because they were like, I don't know where these things are. So that index, you're going to want to keep it handy.
Part of me feels like it's a textbook, so I don't label
So what?
I said part of me feels like it's a textbook, so I have to pay for it.
So you, oh, no, you don't have to pay for it. This is given freely.
I mean, the paper,
the first time. Yes. Okay, but the first time it's given to you freely. There's been an army of alum that have gone off. They've taken Calc 2, they've taken Calc 3, they bring their survival guide with them. I'm going to be ridiculously on your butts about keeping this organized, which is why if you didn't have a binder right now with the dividers, you don't get the stuff. It's not going to stay organized. Everybody good? Mm-hmm. All right, we're going to do a scavenger hunt in a very calm way. Every young man is going to select a young woman to work with. Men, you get to choose. You then have 8 minutes. They have to be someone within this class. Okay, ladies. Ladies, you're just going to get scooped up by some good-looking young man, and you have 8 minutes. Your goal. Your goal is on the special topics handout where it has all the named theorems. Your goal is to find them, write them down. If you want to compact what you write a little bit, that's fine. Pay attention to things like conditions for the function. Does it have to be continuous? Does it have to be differentiable? Is this something that's always true? Okay. Palamon, make sure you pick somebody that has a survival guide. Giselle, make sure you get picked by someone that has a survival guide.
Palamon, do not pick Giselle.
Don't partner up and be like, well, I don't know, let's look around the room for posters. Okay. 8 minutes, make it happen.
I was
going to
pick Giselle for that reason.
Myra?
Okay.
It's time to get comfortable with the survival guide.
Thank you.
The scavenger hunt just for a little bit, and I want to talk about homework this weekend, homework Monday night and Tuesday night. Okay, there is nothing that you are going to physically turn in to me Monday, Tuesday, or Wednesday. Now this scares me to even say the words out loud, because some of you are like, we have no homework for the next 4 nights. That's not what I said.
Vale,
not what I said, son. Right. Not what, just eat your kolache, okay? Eat your kolache. Keep it quiet. Alright. You like the reason that I'm not gonna give you any homework this weekend, Monday or Tuesday, is I know I'm taking up a lot of time on Wednesday. But I also need you to understand that what you're doing Tuesday in class, that practice multiple choice, and the exam after school Wednesday counts as two unit test grades. So what you did last night for area and volume is one grade. This next thing is going to count for two unit test grades. The BC exam that you're going to take in April counts as your final exam grade. That's 7% of your semester exam grade. I'm letting you know about this now so that, and you get the survival guide now, so that you start using it, you start planning around it. So. You've got some post-it notes in the middle of the table, and we're going to go through. Here are sections that I would really encourage you to work on. So in Unit 1, everybody go to Unit 1. In Unit 1, this is when we learned about, and you might want to use the post-it note just to like put a little flag next to your paper if you want to. Unit 1, this is when we learned about limits and continuity and the intermediate value theorem and all the things. What I would really prioritize if I were you, I'm not sure exactly what page it's on, but there's a page in there where it says like process for showing a limit exists, process for showing that a function is continuous at a point. What page is that on? It's in Unit 1. I swear it's in there.
Page 4.
Page 7. Says proving that a limit exists, proving that a function is continuous at a point, applying the mean value theorem. This is going to be especially critical on the free response part of the test. I think that is really important stuff. In Unit 2, so let's all go over to Unit 2, page 5. You might want to put a post-it note here as well. Unit 2, page 5. This should be a very familiar table. This is the summary table of all those FF prime, F double prime relationships. Pretty much every single year, there's one free response question where it's a graphical analysis, functional analysis question. That should be a kind question for you all, but this is where you need to remember things like if F is increasing, then F prime is positive. If a function is concave up, it's been a while. Can you guys show me concave up? Concave up looks something like this, right? The first derivative is? See, like, I don't want you to have this moment on Wednesday. I want it to be automatic. Graph is concave up. F prime is? Increasing. F prime is increasing. F double prime is positive. If my curve is concave up and I draw in a tangent line, the tangent line is always going to be below or under, which means that the tangent line is going to give you an underestimate. Like, these are some of the things we learned in Unit 2. These are mission critical. Page 5. Unit 3. Let's all go to Unit 3. All the derivative rules on pages 3 and 4. Now, I don't just mean the chain rule and the product rule and the quotient rule. I mean that you need to know that the derivative of the tangent of x is secant squared. I need you to remember that the derivative of arctangent of x is
root of one.
Good thing it's in Unit 3 on pages 3 and 4. Arctangent of x.
Oh, it's 1/3.
It's 1 over, not a square root, there's no square root. 1 over 1 plus x squared. I need you to know that the derivative of a to the x, you don't know this one. We've never talked about it. It's in your survival guide. You need to, it's in the section that says, like, if you have extra time or extra ones if you have time. No, it's not there. I just lied to you all.
Yes, it is. A to the x times the natural log of a.
The derivative that you guys know, the derivative of e to the x is e to the x, is a special case. Right, the derivative of e to the x, you guys all just told me right away, is e to the x. I'm telling you that the more generic version says it's a to the x times the natural log of a. You might be like, but wait, these are different. In this case, you're saying the base is e. So the derivative of e to the x is e to the x times the natural log of e. And what's the natural log of e?
1.
This is a special case. This is the general case. Okay. We've not had those conversations because I thought it was like a 30-second conversation that we needed to have. Now, it's over. All right. You need to know all the things. Okay, unit 4. Unit 4, this is where we learned about the mean value theorem. The mean value theorem will show up. It has to. Extreme value theorem. You will need to show that something is an absolute maximum or an absolute minimum, which means you're going to check your endpoints. You're going to find your internal candidate. You're going to evaluate the function and all those things. Unit 4 is when we learned about related rates. We played around with that yesterday. That didn't go well. It's also when we learned about implicit differentiation. Things that you, Unit 4, this was a struggle bus place for everybody. Remember, this was when you're like, my math career is over. I can't do this anymore.
Yeah.
And then there was Unit 5, where suddenly things became good again. Unit 5, Riemann sums.
Oh, yeah.
And the four methods. The four
right.
Methods? There's the left endpoint method.
Right
endpoint method.
Midpoint
method.
Trapezoid
method. You need to know how to do it. You're not going to be asked to name the four. You'll be like, oh, I'm so ready for that question. I'm at least going to get the left and the right and maybe the midpoint. No, you're going to have to be able to do it and show the computations. This is also where we learned about physics and the definite integral. Like the difference between the integral of v of t dt from a to b and the integral from a to b of the absolute value of v of t dt. Very different. One of them is displacement. One of them is total distance traveled. Which one's which?
Total distance traveled is the bottom.
Total distance traveled is the integral of the speed function. Displacement is the integral of the velocity function. All those things. Okay, unit 6. Unit 6, let's go over to unit 6. In unit 6, this is where you learned all the integration formulas. This is where you started to get confused, some of you, with am I finding a derivative or am I finding an integral? You want to be really careful. This might be a good time to get yourself a tattoo. Remember the tattoo was S, C, negative S, negative C. The S stood for sine, cosine, negative cosine. When you are going in the clockwise direction, we're thinking about these are derivatives. If you're going in the counterclockwise, these are antiderivatives. So if I said, I see you, hold on. So if I said, what's the antiderivative of cosine, everybody would say,
sine.
Antiderivative of cosine.
Sine.
Derivative of cosine?
Negative sine.
Negative sine. Okay, what if I said, I remember this from my AP exam. Start with sine of x and take 100 derivatives. Take 100 derivatives of sine. Not take the derivative 100, you know, derivative of sine is cosine, do it again, do that 100 times. But take one derivative, derivative of sine is cosine, derivative of cosine is negative sine. Third derivative?
Negative.
Fourth derivative?
Sine.
Fifth derivative?
Cosine.
100th derivative?
Negative sine.
Sine.
Negative sine.
It's negative sine.
1, 2, 3. This is the fourth derivative. The fourth derivative of sine is sine. So the 100th derivative? 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. This is where you're going to get to on multiples of 4. This is the 100th derivative. Totally blew my mind in the middle of the AP exam. I was like, I don't have time to find the derivative 100 times. And I was like, oh, there's a pattern. Yeah. That was good. That was good. All right. You will also need to know, I just realized the camera's pointing in the wrong direction. Okay, you all know that the integral of e to the x is
e to the x,
Plus Charlie. That means you also now know how to find the antiderivative of e to the x. I applaud the bravery. It will not be a to the x times the natural log of a. That's what happens when you take the derivative of
negative.
A.
Negative. No.
Look it up in the survival guide. The integral of a to the x. Lewis, you look like you're on strike. You're like, no, I will not look this up in the survival guide. What's the answer? It's still up on the board. The antiderivative of a to the x. It's in your survival guide. In unit 6. A to the x is close.
Oh, over ln a.
You're going to divide by the ln of a. Because remember, the way that you check, you take a derivative. And ln a is a constant, ln of a is a constant. The derivative of a to the x is a to the x multiplied by the natural log of a. Of course, I'm going to have to divide by natural log of a so that they will cancel out. Okay, I realize these are not things that we've talked about. There are things in the survival guide we have not discussed, and you might still like to see a question. Yeah.
If I tattoo the survival guide on me, is that cheating?
That's a whole lot of skin.
So
I think you're not going to be able to do that, tattooed lady. Okay, unit 7, this is when we hit differential equations. Now, here's the thing. In unit 7, we went further than the AB kids did. We did Euler's method. We did logistic growth. The only thing that's going to be assessed on Wednesday is solving differential equations like separation of variables. Like Super Charlie, we were really good at this. Slope fields, going to be on there. And just general solving differential equations, things like words like directly proportional, inversely proportional, it's in your survival guide. Unit 8, good news. It's what we just did. So I would expect that you guys are gonna be supremely comfortable in Unit 8, but you need to know all your like area, volume of revolution, volume by cross-section stuff. Your homework assignment over this weekend, Monday night, Tuesday night, is do what you need to do to get ready for this exam. I'm giving you the time and the space and the resources to get your house in order circle book. Pretty good. Questions about survival guide, the exam, anything else? Andrew, you okay? Okay, can I get the two of you like back over here with all the friends? And Steven, can you go back to managing the camera? All right. So, I'm not going to go back to the scavenger hunt experience. Part of it is I spent a bit more time talking about the homework assignments.
Oh, okay.
But here's what I know. Every single thing that's on here is in your survival guide, and you can finish this off on your own. Okay? Here's where I want to go. I want to take you guys with me over to free response question number 2. It's on the bottom of page 6. Yep. So we're looking at the back here. Bottom of page 6. I'm having technical difficulties. All right, this question, I love this question. Love it, love it, love it. And this is totally fair game. This is the kind of question I want this to be easy for you. However, if you haven't practiced with the things, it's not going to go well. So why don't you take a minute, read through this, and ready to talk in just a bit. Velocity measured in meters per second, and acceleration A measured in meters per second per second. For selected values of t shown below in the table, both v and a are differentiable in 0 to 45. Okay. Part A, on the time interval 0 to 45, what is the minimum number of times that the vehicle has stopped? On your fingers, please. How many times? What's the minimum number of times? Okay. See, pretty unanimously, 2 times. Andrew, how did you make the decision 2 times? I 100% agree with you, 2 times.
I looked at the graph.
You looked at the, there's a graph here?
I mean, not the graph, the table.
The table?
Yeah, and then watch our velocity, that it equals the same number on 2 separate time intervals.
So I hear you saying you looked at the velocity, and you see that it's the same on 2 different intervals? Where?
On 10 and 25 is -6.2.
Okay, at 10 and 25, -6.2. So you're saying that means that the velocity, the vehicle has stopped?
Yeah.
Don't agree with you. That's not what it means if the car has stopped. If the vehicle has stopped, what's the thing that you know for sure, Myra?
From 0 to 10, the velocity went from positive to negative.
Okay, so but let's start there. If the vehicle has stopped, what that means is that the velocity is equal to 0. So that's that opening connection. Now your answer of 2 times is great, but just saying 2 isn't going to get you the point. So how many times is the velocity going to be equal to 0? Once in here, right? Paloma, like, why? How do you know for sure that the vehicle has stopped in this interval? What do you know for sure?
Since it goes from 4.5 to negative, you know it's going to have to, if it's continuous, it's going to have to go at 0 at some point.
Okay, now, I have no doubt you've got all the right ideas in your head, and there are so many things wrong with what he just said. I'm wondering how many of you guys actually heard what he just said. One more time.
Wait.
What'd you say?
Right,
you said it like 5 times in a row. It hurt my heart so much. I almost died. You said it.
Oh.
Don't use the word it. We're going back to these days.
The velocity
is 4.5 meters per second at time 0. It's -6.2 over here at 10 seconds. What do we know has to be happening in between? The velocity has to be equal to 0, but even with that, you have to back it up. You have to tell me, why do we know this? Okay, so I want to see something like V is differentiable. Now, here's the thing. Differentiable is important, but really the thing that you need in order to do this is not differentiability.
Which means it's continuous.
Right, what this means is that V is continuous. So if the velocity is continuous, the theorem that we get to use? Uh-huh. See, this will happen on Wednesday. This is why we're practicing. If the function is continuous, what this means is that the IVT applies. Okay? From here, what you do is you look at the endpoints, and the process is mapped out for you. The velocity at time 0 is 4.5. The velocity at time 10 is -6.2. Why do I know that the vehicle has stopped in this interval? It is because the number that I'm looking for is going to be careful. Tell no lies. The velocity at time 10 is less than 0. The velocity at time 0 is greater than 0. Therefore, V of t equals 0. Got to get this part right. at least once. At least once on the interval 0 to 10. There once was a time where you guys were all really good with this, but that was back in August. A lot has happened since. Mm-hmm. Everybody okay? Here's the good news. Pretty much everybody knew just from looking at the data table, two times. You knew two times. That's one. Where's the other one? Lewis, where's the other one?
At 40.
At 40, right? This is like a giveaway. At time 40. Any other times?
Then you can be, that you can prove.
Nothing that you could prove. Is it possible that the car stops between 20 and 25 seconds?
Yep. Yes.
It's possible, but it doesn't have to be true. Going from negative to negative didn't get you anything. It's the switch from positive to negative. This is the guarantee. So one time there, and then I'd say something like via, what's the other one?
40.
Via 40. Via 40 is equal to 0. Therefore, V of t equals 0 at least twice on the time interval where we're going 0 to 45. And I hope everybody's okay. You want to make sure that you get at least twice in there because it could be more. Big mistakes that some people make, maybe not so much the 10 of you, they start naming the wrong function. Right? They do like f. The function's name is not f, the function's name is v. They tell lies in the inequality. If you tell me v of 0 is less than 0 is less than v of 10, it doesn't matter what you write after this because you're telling me some lies. Everybody okay? All right, so that's A. All right, B, have a conversation with somebody near you. What's the minimum number of times that the speed is 1 meter per second? Need the speed to be 1 meter per second.
Could you go back up?
It's positive whenever the acceleration and the velocity are at the same time.
I hear people lying to their neighbors.
Sorry.
Yes.
Point
to be chief liar. Yeah. If the speed is equal to 1, I don't have speed information in the table, right? If the speed is equal to 1, this means something. Again with the it.
Speed is positive.
Oh my gosh, no. If the speed is equal to 1, there's only two ways that the speed could be equal to 1. What you have is velocity information. If the speed is equal to 1, what has to be true about the velocity is that the velocity is equal to 1. That's a way that the speed could be equal to 1. What's the other way?
Absolute value.
Absolute value.
Right, speed is absolute value of B of T, which means that the velocity could be equal to 1, or the velocity could be negative. So now I'm going to look at my velocity graph with fresh eyes and say, how many times, what's the minimum number of times velocity is equal to 1? One time in here, right? Anywhere else? No. 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 Yes. Okay, so two times, and you would go through the argument and you'd write everything out.
So
minimum number of times velocity is equal to negative 1.
Three times, according to what you said.
Well, wait. Velocity equal to 1?
Wouldn't it be two times there because it's negative 1 and positive
1? Okay, hold on. I think I know what's happening. I'm looking at this just asking the question, when is velocity equal to 1?
Oh.
Just velocity equal to 1. Then, because my old man brain, I can only hold so many thoughts. Now I look for when's velocity equal to negative 1. Possible?
Yes.
Yes?
No.
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 Yes. Yes. Two times. There's a grand total of 4 times right? On this interval, 0 to 4.5, my velocity is going to be equal to 1 at some point, and the velocity is equal to negative 1 at some point. So I've got two times happening over here, and you'd write the whole thing out. And sadly, we're out of time. Part C, for 0 less than or equal to t less than or equal to 45, must there be a time where the acceleration is equal to 0?
No.
Is the wrong answer.
Yeah.
It's a carefully constructed question. If I'm asking you about acceleration equal to 0, I understand that you looked here and you're like, no, these are all positives. But the other thing to remember about acceleration is I'm asking you about the derivative. Is there a time where the derivative of velocity is going to be equal to 0? This is where I want to be thinking about not IVT, but the MVT. And I think, Andrew, this is going to be now where like you zoom in and you're like, oh, on this interval 10 to 25, the y values are the same, the velocities are the same. So the mean value theorem says if I look at the slope of the tangent line, secant line connecting those two, that's equal to 0. So the slope of the tangent line has to be equal to 0. I know we went fast there, but here's the big takeaway. If you do nothing between now and Wednesday to get ready for this exam, it is going to be a bloodbath for the 10 of you. As bright as you are, as gifted as you are, what you need between now and Wednesday is practice recalling all the things. You've got all the materials, you've got the time, get it done. David, thank you for the clutches.
Steven. See you later. I'll check in with you on Monday. Yep.
Or just for specific students?
Neither Polymone nor Giselle brought in their binder and dividers. So I shouldn't have given them the survival guide. But they need it for this weekend. So. Alright, I just need to get the video.